People in wheelchairs left on the streets. The war on poverty has become the war on the impoverished. We're going to take a look at that during this program. We must stand together against the hate crimes that are being issued toward the homeless in mid-America. We must stand in solidarity through the love of Christ. Be sure you stay tuned. I'm Larry Rice, and this is Here's Help. There are so many hurting and homeless people at this particular time. We're seeing growing numbers of people sent to us at the 1411 Locust facility who are in wheelchairs. People are hurting. People are homeless. And as I speak of homelessness, it doesn't just relate to the city of St. Louis. It relates to all of Mid-America, including Springfield, Missouri. We see over 200 people a day coming into our Veterans Coming Home Center in Springfield, Missouri, and so many others that are in need. But I speak of St. Louis because we're seeing all-out war right now on poverty. The war on poverty has become the war on the impoverished. In the city of St. Louis, they get big money from the federal government. And it's like this: if agencies don't take their money because they want to get as much in as they can, they want these agencies to participate in a homeless count so they get more federal dollars in so they can pay salaries. They've already taken over the Abram building that was federal surplus property that outright belonged to the homeless. They put the city offices in there and fought off the homeless from being there. Now they're trying to destroy another homeless encampment in downtown St. Louis, a very organized homeless encampment. They've had no crime or problems there. The homeless vote on who's going to come in there. They've elected a mayor. They got a fence around it. And yet they want to destroy that. At the same time, they're trying to stop New Life from sheltering the homeless. So again, if they can't control it, they want to kill it. But what they're going to end up doing is ending up destroying the lives of people. I have with me Vince at this time. Vince, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Vince, actually from St. Louis County. Been trying to get St. Louis County to open a shelter out in that area. Bell Fountain Neighbors out came in. He ended up going to a hospital. Is that correct?
Yes. Yes.
Was it a stroke you had?
I went into the hospital for pneumonia my last day there for pneumonia. I was being discharged, and I had a stroke while I was tying my shoe to leave.
Wow. And so then you went to a rehab center, and then...
Well, I spent another 2 weeks in the hospital, and then they sent me to a rehab facility.
And then the rehab facility gave you cab fare, and you came here. You didn't have anywhere else to go?
No.
How important is it that New Life Evangelistic Center stays open, that we resist this city order that came down, that they want us to reduce our population by 90% on May 12th?
Well, I think that they're making a life and death decision. And they need to think of it in such terms.
And explain that.
It's not a matter of preference. People like myself, I mean, to me, it's life or death. I can live, I can have a new life, or I can end up possibly dying on the streets with no health care, et cetera. It's absolutely the bottom line.
And that's what they want us to do, is to leave them on the streets in their wheelchairs to die out there. Do you not care? Do you not care? Then please get your church directly involved. Get hundreds of people to join you and us. And when on March the 12th, I move out to the streets with the homeless, those that are being driven out of the homeless encampments, those that wouldn't be able to stay at New Life if we had to close. Organize. We'll send you a complete organizational kit if you call us, 314-881-3218, and say, look, I want to do this. 314-881-3218. I thank God for those who are speaking up on behalf of the homeless at this hour.
I'll tell you a little bit about my organization. And it was created to be somewhat of a solution. We work with fathers to try to get them back involved in their children's lives. That's our first premise, as a means to get their dad to become emotionally as well as financially supportive of his children. The father, he is supposed to be the head, therefore he's supposed to be involved to try to model good stuff so that his children don't fall through too many pitfalls. Sounds real good, don't it? Except for when the dad himself has already had to face a whole lot of different pitfalls. We have to put together sustained numbers. We can't let Ferguson go away.
That's right.
Sustained, orderly numbers. We cannot be purchased by them putting together a commission. A commission.
Starting on the commission.
We have to stand with Larry.
That's right.
This is a huge fight that he's facing, and it has direct implications for us. communities. If they're not at Larry's place, where would they be at?
That's right, at your place.
Not let you do it at 2 o'clock in the morning?
That's right. That's right. That's right. You ain't going to get away from them.
No, they're going to open your porch. Huh?
But
porch,
there are some structural things
fall over when you come
that
the
still
door.
Need fixing. You know, we walked away from the fight thinking that we had won it. Mm-hmm. We were bought off and appeased.
That's right.
We have an excellent time right now to pick the banner up. Folks talk about worldly leaders, worldly. There's a lot of leaders in St. Louis.
That's right.
But in order for me to lead, I got to have some followers.
That's right. That's right.
And I don't want just them blind followers. I want some followers that got some insight. Give me some energy. Give me some ideas. Give me some direction. Help me out with this thing that you want to make me be the one to take the bullet first.
Mm-hmm.
So help me out with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know.
That's how they punish you. They snatch your contract.
We got to come up. Well, I work with solutions, but the solutions that I'm dealing with the guys that I work with, it's a mandate still. Because until we get to the root cause of these situations, which is an economic problem, it is not a social problem, it's an economic problem. Until we can get to getting some changes in that area, it'll always be mandates.
Yep.
You know, we live in a system of society, a system whereas a guy who cannot afford to pay his child support goes to the penitentiary.
Exactly.
Gets another strike on his name.
Right.
Does that make him any more able to be able to afford, or does that help him to get to Larry Rice quick? Because he ain't gonna be able to find no job.
That's right.
But I do encourage you all, you know, gave him a sign. Talk with your friends about whatever you think that you're hearing tonight. Talk with your friends about the fight that Larry is up against. And get others engaged. You know, and if you can't find Larry, you can find Hassan. You sure can find this one right here. Shaheed, that's what we used to call him, was paying Shaheed. He don't go away. He don't go away. You know, join in on it. Stop standing on the sidelines. Join in. And you don't want to make your presence physical. If I could only get about 150,000 people to get Larry $5.
Have mercy. Have mercy.
Be a whole lot different going on right now. $5. Not 100, but we need them adults. St. Louis has, 250,000 African-Americans that make it an African-American city. We get half of them to get $5.
Mm. Yes, if everybody would do something and just pitch in at this time and help New Life Evangelistic Center with their legal defense fund. We have attorneys in the St. Louis area that are working on this. We have attorneys in Michigan that are working on a federal level on this. Yes, we're going to continue to fight for the right for the people to have a place to sleep at night. My next guest is from Ferguson, Missouri. She was living in Ferguson. She lost her home. And tell everyone your name.
Shannon Morris.
Shannon, the only place you could come was New Life Evangelistic Center? How important is it the place was open to you?
Very important, because if not, I'd be on the streets.
Shannon, you were part of our 30-day transitional housing program. Now you want to be part of a 90-day program?
Yes.
What happened to you during that 30 days? How did it help you?
It's like, I don't, sorry.
Yeah. I mean, what if the doors hadn't been open to you? What if we'd have said, nope, we can't let you in here? They had police standing outside the building. They turned you away because they said, the Board of Public Service issued its decree, New Life Evangelistic Center cannot take more than 32 people. It's got that in there already. You got to be out on the streets.
I probably wouldn't be here right now.
Where would you be?
I probably wouldn't be alive.
Tell us why.
Because I have kidney disease, so any kind of infections could kill me.
So people in wheelchairs come to us, people with kidney disease, and you could pick up infections out there?
Mm-hmm.
So when they issue a sentence like that, it's actually a slow death sentence for people?
Yes. I was actually... I went to my doctor last week, and I went from stage 2 in September to now I'm stage 3.
Stage 3. How does it help you? Not only does it give you a place to sleep here, food to eat, but how does the community support help you?
I mean, they're here for me when I need someone to talk to or what I'm going through right now. I got a lot of people here to help me.
So it's actually like a family that they're trying to destroy by trying to stop us from sheltering the homeless.
Yes, it is.
If you could say whatever you wanted to, or if you could testify before that all those people that Board of Public Service, which were departmental heads, all there, what would you say to them?
Don't shut this door because it's, you know, it's the place for us to be. I mean, this is the best place for all of us to be right now.
I mean, we even saw the recreational director, he said, do it. We saw the health and person that heads up the health for the city of St. Louis, all of them just kind of voting to shut down. What would you say about that? What would you say to them?
Don't do it.
Yeah. So where do we go now? We're going to go and we have to take it to the courts because we can't just let this lady and others die out there. I thank God for those advocates on behalf of the homeless that have been standing with us and community forums they've been having and the like. And I just praise God for all of you that are supporting the work of New Life Evangelistic Center and donating at this time. I do not know if you realize how you're helping to save lives, literally saving lives through your involvement at the New Life Evangelistic Center. There's another case of one who is sick that literally could die out there if we did not continue to keep the doors open. And we're going to continue to keep the doors open as a result of all of you that are praying for us here now and caring and sharing. And again, it's a family, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Do you got hope now that you didn't have before?
Oh, yes.
What kind of hope do you have?
That there's a better future out there.
Are you growing in your faith?
Yes, I am.
In what ways?
I mean, I'm going to church every day. I'm actually reading the Word, you know, every day, and I didn't do that before.
You didn't? So you're drawn closer to Jesus through all
of
us.
Yes, I am.
So we invite you to help us. It's New Life Evangelistic Center. Evangelism means good news, sharing that good news, not only in word, but also in deed. And that's what we're trying to do. And I really thank God for those of you that are sharing and caring. You know, there's so many misconceptions concerning the homeless out there. They are not bums. They could be your coworker. They could be just about anybody, couldn't they?
Mm-hmm.
There are many, they could be a person has a medical problem, person lost their job. A person that couldn't pay the rent anymore. I'm sure a few years back you didn't think about that you'd be homeless, did you?
No, I didn't.
How have you learned? What have you gained by, being a part, by being here and seeing the homeless and working with them?
Being a lot stronger person and right. Not judging people now.
And we thank God for those of you that have already seen that and perhaps haven't had to experience homelessness. For others of you, we pray that your eyes may be open. And you may see and hear the Word of God. Yes, truly the Word of God. It's filled with mandates to be hospitable, to provide compassion. And our Lord Himself said that foxes have holes, birds have nests, but He, the Son of Man, had nowhere to lay His head. I thank God for those who are seeing the homeless in the new light and the love of our Lord.
The face of homelessness, I was asked to share my personal experience with people that experience homelessness. So, what I'm here to represent or get across is there is a different face of homelessness that we normally assume. When we think of homelessness, like Gwen has said before, Reverend Rice said before, we think of vagrants, we think of the unkempt, uneducated, or mentally ill, substance abusers, or what have you. But in the last 2 years, for me, I was traumatized to find out that I had coworkers that went to work every day that were actually living out of their cars. And I had to experience where, if you remember back in July of 2012, when we had the bad heat wave and, you know, people's powers were going out, power was going out across the city. And I received a call from her, from this co-worker, and I'm going to preface this with saying that our relationship was that of just co-worker. And I had met that person maybe a year or two before. We didn't have what was considered a camaraderie. We were just co-workers, and I met them at training classes. We didn't even work in the same office. But we had exchanged numbers, and I realized, you know, I know my people. So she called me one night, and it was the hottest night in July of 2012. She called me, and she asked me, could she come over and iron for tomorrow, for work tomorrow? And I said, sure. And my assumption was she was just in the area that didn't have power. Well, she came over, she ironed, and after she, when she got ready to leave, her back is towards me, and she's leaving at my door, and she goes, I guess I'll go and try to find a hotel lot to stay on. And I heard her mumbling, and she said, because I don't have money for a hotel. And when I heard her say, I said, wait a minute, what are you saying? And she just started bawling, crying. And I said, well, wait a minute, what do you mean you're going to go on a lot and sleep in your car? She can't sleep in the car with the air on, so she's going to be hot. And I told her, I said, well, no, I can't. You can't go out in the night like that. And I didn't know, you know, so we talked, and she told me her story. And she went to work every day. So she stayed with me a couple of months, July, August, and then September, she moved back. She was originally from Michigan, so I convinced her that she didn't have any root system here, any family, everybody that was here that she knew was just friends. And I convinced her to go back home, you know, to her mother. And I said, we got to do something. I said, because you have a population of people that people don't even realize they could be sitting right next to you right at this moment and be technically homeless. And so it's not just, I'm just here to say, and in my work capacity, I had clients that wound up homeless. They didn't have a support system. They were probationers or parolees that either had burned bridges with their families or whatever. And you have, like I said, you have educated people that may lose their jobs. All of a sudden, they're homeless now. And we don't have any programs, and the programs that we have, it's like they're set up to disqualify people. Either you got this part, but you don't got this part, or you can go to this center, but we don't like drug abusers. You can't come in my shelter here. You can't do this. It's a lot of bureaucracy going on with that. So I studied coming here and doing my spiel or whatever. I researched, I should say, different statistics. I'm not going to bombard you with the statistics, but I will say this. As far as the nation, they think that homelessness is being addressed as best as it can because there's a reduction in the number, but they're not realizing that there are homeless people that are not even being counted. So we can stand here all day and say, yeah, we got so many amount of homeless people. Like even in St. Louis, they want a lot of classes from last year. There was a reduction in the homeless figures, but they're only counting the people that they made contact with in shelters or on park benches. What about the people I'm talking about? And where are the programs for people that just get down on their luck or something and wind up in that situation? And I'm not trivializing saying that, oh, we should just start on this level here. I'm saying in America, the melting pot of the world, we should not have the homeless problem that we have. And what happens to the rest of the people that aren't veterans, that are homeless? What happens to the children? There's a high, high number of children under the age of 18 that are homeless. And I'm going to say another thing. I remember when my daughter was in school, she graduated from the Maplewood Richmond Heights School District. And in 2006, I was on a first name basis and really tight, you know, relationship with the superintendent. They brought the Dr. Hinkey in. Before my daughter had started in the school district had been unaccredited. Dr. Hinkey came in, turned everything around, they got their accreditation back, and they realized they had students in school that were doing fine, A students, and all of a sudden, their grades are tanking. So they wanted to find out what was going on, and they found out that those children that were they were experiencing homelessness. That's what the problem was. So you have teenagers who are, I won't say orphaned, but because of the displacement and because of homelessness, they don't have anywhere to go. They come to school to get food, and they're big enough to where their parents have to sacrifice them for the younger, for their younger siblings. So all of a sudden, they're, you know, they're not getting their education because they're worried about where they're going to sleep tonight or where they're, you know, where they can go. So they did, Dr. Hickey sent out a notice to select parents, and they instituted what's called Joe's Place, and it's still there. And I, when they had the grand opening, they bought a house in connection with, it was a Maplewood School District, a Presbyterian church, and some coalitions to end homelessness. They bought this house and got together, bought a two-story house out there in Maplewood, right around the corner from the high school. And they're housing young men there that are that have experienced homelessness so that they can stay in school and get their education.
We are seeing so many people come to us at the New Life Evangelistic Center. We have people sent to us by hospitals. We have people that could die out on those streets if they're left out there. And the ongoing cutbacks that are taking place in mental health programs. Steve was in Cape Girardeau for like 8 months in a mental hospital there, and then they sent him to Festus, got his medications adjusted, and they put you in a van and dropped you off at New Life Evangelistic Center?
Yes, sir.
And you'd been suffering from severe depression?
Yes, sir.
Now, you know, they spend all that time and money and energy getting you stabilized, and if they'd had to drop you off on the streets, what would that have done for your depression?
It would have made it a lot worse.
Had you contemplated suicide in the past?
Yes.
Did you attempt it?
Yes.
What did you do?
I tried to overdose.
If this place did not take you in, do you think you might have gone that way again?
Yes, I believe I would have.
You would have. How is it offering you hope by being here at New Life Evangelistic Center?
Being structured and Christian-based really helps my mindset.
It really helps your mindset. Mm-hmm. Helps you to know that there is a higher power, that there is God there.
Right.
And also, it gives you a purpose. I mean, you volunteer a few hours each day. You get
right.
to help other people.
Right.
How does that help you?
That makes me feel good.
Does it? Like
it gives
really
me something to do instead of just being out on the streets.
You got a sense of purpose now.
Right.
And through all this, you believe you're getting closer to Jesus?
Yes, I do.
People being set free from the cycle of homelessness, don't let them stop New Life Evangelistic Center. Brothers and sisters, you're needed at this time. Unless your church is going to open its doors, and we'd be happy to send some folks to your place, then you need to stand with us and help us to continue to keep the doors open. If they want to cut the number of people that are coming to New Life Evangelistic Center, all the county and the city has to do is open additional shelters, give people a place to go, place to come. Then they will automatically see the different numbers get smaller and smaller. If people will simply do what the Bible tells us to do. When Jesus said, "When I was a stranger, did you welcome me?" He said, "As oft you've done to the least of these," he said, "even so you've done it to me." People that have physical problems, that are in a wheelchair, shouldn't be left on the streets to die. People that have severe kidney problems, diabetes problems, shouldn't be left out there to die. And people that are struggling with severe depression shouldn't be put back out on the streets. And that's what will happen if you do nothing. I'm asking you to pray for us here at the New Life Evangelistic Center at this time. I'm asking you to let God's light and love flow in you and through you. It's a matter of life and death for many, many people. You're involved in a transitional housing program at this time.
Yes.
And you see, this is a way that you're going to then be able to stabilize, find hope.
Yes.
And go on and live a productive life.
Yes.
You do.
Yes, sir, I do.
And you've got some hope at this time.
Yes.
He's got hope. Because of those of you that are sharing with New Life Evangelistic Center. P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, that's 63166. He's not alone, though. More and more people are discovering that there is hope. They're discovering that Christ is risen.
My name's Lori, and I do have some hope here.
You said you have some hope here.
Yeah.
Tell me about your situation before you came here.
My husband had passed away, and I lost my home due to that.
How long ago was this?
About a year.
And you've been back and forth on the street since then?
Yeah.
What's it like being a woman? And like, for example, your age, that's out on the street?
It's very lonely. It's very upsetting.
Mother Teresa said that loneliness is the worst form of poverty. So you'd find yourself very lonely, is that?
Mm-hmm.
Did you have a tendency to get depressed like the last gentleman?
Absolutely.
Very depressed?
Absolutely.
Had you ever had to sleep outside?
Yes.
So your husband died.
Mm-hmm.
Feelings of rejection, loneliness,
mm-hmm.
despair?
Right.
Did you ever contemplate suicide?
Mm-hmm.
You did. But God brought you to new life now.
Right.
You're part of a transitional housing program.
Right.
You feel like you're part of a family?
Yes.
Why is it so important that we keep that family together, that we fight off those principalities and powers that are trying to destroy it right now?
It's important to have some place to be, somewhere to work.
And if a person doesn't have that?
They feel pretty hopeless.
And you were battling hopelessness a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Hopelessness is like being shoved underwater. We can't breathe. I mean, hope is like oxygen for the soul. Couldn't you say that?
Right.
You'd come in at nights a lot of times, a lot of nights then after you discovered this place prior to coming to transitional housing. I would see you come in at nights. Didn't you come into the night shelter at times?
No, I came in during the day.
You came in during the day. But you came in, you'd spend the night here.
Mm-hmm.
And then you decided that, well, you wanted more than just a shelter. You wanted to get involved in a program, didn't you?
Right.
She's part of a transitional housing program. It's an exciting program. They help other homeless people here. They have a sense of purpose. And then women go from a 30-day program to a 90-day program all the time. They're out looking for jobs. They're applying it. And they want to destroy all this. Considering New Life Evangelistic Center a nuisance? They consider Jesus such a nuisance. They executed him. He rose from the dead, though. They considered Daniel a nuisance and threw him in the lion's den. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego thrown in the fiery furnace. In fact, each and every person that tries to live according to the mandates of Scripture, sooner or later, may find themselves considered a nuisance. But we're going to continue to declare the love and power of our Lord Jesus Christ. We're doing everything to have a safe, clean place here, isn't it?
That's right.
And they know that we're trying to abide by all the different city codes, but they don't want to see the homeless in the neighborhood. It's hate crimes is what it is. Why do I call it a crime? It's when just because people lost their homes, a widow loses her home, and they want to regulate her to sleep in vacant buildings, sleep out on the streets. Even when the homeless come together in this encampment, like they are down on the river, they're trying to destroy that encampment because they want to put a football stadium in there. Fund a billionaire to build a stadium so millionaires can come and spend up to $10,000 for seats, for PSLs and whatever it is to finance this thing, and after they squeeze the taxpayers for it. Who's going to stand up against this ungodliness? Who's going to speak up and speak out? We give you an opportunity on March the 12th, where we're actually for a night. I'm going to move out on the streets with the homeless, and for a night, we're just not going to be open one night so they can get an idea of what it's going to be like. How many is sick and handicapped? Be hurting it, homeless, night after night, week after week. Will you stand in solidarity one night with them? Will you understand what it is to be told to go from place to place and have no place to lay your head? Call us now and become a part of this outreach on that night, on March the 12th, as they want to keep the homeless out of sight and out of mind when we're going to be very much in sight and very much in mind. Call now. 314-881-3218. Why don't you get your church group directly involved? See it, experience it, what it's like to feel what Jesus felt when he said that foxes have holes and birds have nests, but he, the Son of Man, had nowhere to lay his head. Get behind the fight to help keep New Life open by supporting the Legal Defense Fund and help us as we fix up our shelter and make it even a better place for people by sharing your gift now with New Life Evangelistic Center, 314-436-2424. You can call or you can send your gift. P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, 63166. Go to www.newlifeevangelisticcenter.org.